So anyways, it's good to be in church, and I'm glad. We've got this banner today that says, I have decided. I just wanted to talk about that a little bit. I've put off 1 week the sermon series that I wanted to start this week called Wonder Women. I know some of you are like, what? I brought all my girlfriends with me. But this week, you're going to have to bring them back next week, okay? If you're here and you're like, I was ready to be a Wonder Woman today, you are, praise the Lord, you are all still. But next week, I'll tell you more about that. So you can come back and be a Wonder Woman. What would I know about being a Wonder Woman? But anyways, you come on back next week and we'll talk about that. But this week, I have decided to talk about because it just matters to me, this whole thing. I was just too excited about Baptism Sunday and what's going on here to not share a little bit about it. And honestly, I just want you to, I'll prime the pump a little bit. Right off the bat, I'm sort of wondering if there might be some people in here who haven't decided up until this point and are going to decide today and are going to find themselves in the baptism tank today and didn't even plan on it. And so I'm just going to prime the pump a little bit. Some of you are like, uh-oh, so maybe start feeling God speaking to you right away. And let's just carry on, though. Yesterday, I got to go swimming at the Comox Valley Recreation Center. Anyone had a good swim at that pool? You! Yeah, I know you guys have. We saw a few Northgaters there actually spending time in the pool. And my daughter, last time we went to the pool, I remember her looking up at the water slide. You know, Daddy, what's that big green swirly thing? Like, that's a water slide. Yeah, it's pretty fun. Izzy, do you want to try it out? And she was like, no. Nuh-uh, not a chance. I'm like, okay, sounds good. Well, last time we went, she was sort of trying to look at it. She kept seeing kids coming down with smiling faces and was sort of, I don't know. And I didn't even know if she was allowed to go on. So I said, do you just want to go check if you're allowed to go on? It is, you know, okay, let's go check. And I said, hey, can she go with me? They said, no, she has to be this tall. We measured her, and she was tall enough. And so we're like, I said, Izzy, now's that point. Like, the water slide's there. You've seen the smiling faces. You've heard the laughter. You've checked it all out. Now, if you want, you can go down that slide and you can have some fun on the water slide. And it's going to be a good day. Do you want to do that? She's like, no. No, Dad. Definitely not. Let's get out of here. You know. And so we left that day. I wasn't going to force her. I'm like, you know, that would be cruel, actually. Get down the slide. So I was like, okay, sounds good. We'll go home, and that's no problem. Meanwhile, our little Hardy is like, I want to go on the slide. I'm like, quiet down, kid. Let's leave. And so this week, we went yesterday, and we showed up, and Izzy saw her same, slide, the same daunting giant that she couldn't face last time, and she looked at that thing and saw it, and I was like, Izzy, do you want to go down that slide today? No, not a chance. Okay, sounds good. So we're just swimming around, and all of a sudden, like, literally, I don't even know what happened. We weren't talking about it, nothing. Izzy comes up to me, she goes, Daddy, I'm ready to go down the slide. I'm like, okay, here we go. And I'm thinking she's going to get afraid at some point. I'm like, you want me to take off your life jacket? Because once you take it off, then you got to go down. Yeah, I'm ready to go down the slide. I take it off. We start walking up the stairs. And if you've ever walked up stairs to a water slide, you know you're walking up, and Hardy's with us. He goes, I can see a lot, Daddy. I'm like, shh, don't tell Izzy. Like, we're not that high, Izzy. No, no problem. We're just a little bit up. And close your eyes if you want. I'll carry you. But we're walking up, and I keep thinking she's going to, no, I don't want to do it. Well, she walks right up. Dad, go way down below and wait for me, because I'm going to be coming in a second. I want you to see me. I'm like, are you serious? Like, yeah. So I thought maybe I'm just never going to see her. She's going to go up there, and eventually I'm going to go up and bring her down the stairs. Well, she comes down the slide, smiley face, splashes. She goes, let's do it again, you know? She just pumped on it, so she went, yay, Izzy, yeah. So she went down the slide 3 or 4 times, and then eventually I'm like, hey, I'm freezing, Iz. Can you get me back in the pool? And she but she had to decide, right? It wasn't about, like, the slide existed no matter what. The slide was always going to be there. Kids were going down it. It was always a thing no matter what. But she had to decide that she was going to go down it to experience that. She had to decide that she was going to put away her fears, that she was going to climb the stairs, take off her life jacket, and step onto that slide and come all the way down. She had to make that decision. It wasn't my decision to make for her. I brought her to the pool. I could bring her right up to the slide. I could walk up the stairs with her. I could wait at the bottom for her. I could do all of those things. But at some point, she had to decide for herself, what am I going to do now with this slide? It exists. It works, everything's good, other people use it, but what am I going to do with this slide? One of my favorite authors, and he's a pastor over in Washington, D.C., his name's Mark Batterson, and my favorite things that he says is, you are always only one decision away from a drastically different life. You're always only one decision away from a radically different life. From a life that you weren't living all the way up until that point, you're always only one decision from radically changing it for the good or for the bad. For to turn in a really bad way or to turn in a really good way. To turn in a really lazy way or a really empowered way. You're always only one decision away from a radically, drastically different life. I mean, some of us look around and we think that things are just going to happen to us. Maybe your financial situation isn't all that great. And you think, I just can't wait until that changes. I can't wait until all of a sudden something else happens and I gain money and things just settle down. Maybe it's just one decision you need to make to spend less money. You know, maybe it's just one decision you need to make to budget or to do things differently. Maybe it's your marriage. I can't wait till I have a fulfilled marriage. I know it's out there. I know I've seen good marriages. People have told me there's good marriages. And I really believe with all my heart that it's going to happen for me too. And it can happen. And it was there before and it's not there anymore. Maybe it's just one decision that you have to say, I am, no matter what, going to be the man or the woman that I need to be for this marriage, whether they are or not. Maybe that's the decision that needs to be made. No matter what, this is who I am. Drastically will change your life. Maybe some of you are sitting around waiting to see if a career comes up that you really want. You know you're supposed to go to school, but you're kind of wondering if maybe something else will happen and something will just land on your plate. And maybe the drastic decision that you need to make that will radically alter your life is just to go and get your degree. Maybe it's to go back to school. Maybe it's to go work for something. Maybe it's to go give your efforts to that thing. Maybe it's forgiveness, that your family is just shattered. Your family's all a mess and broken, and you can't figure out what is going on, and you keep waiting for that moment when that person who's hurt you is going to come back to you and say, they shouldn't have done it, and I'm so sorry, and I can't believe it. You know it could happen, and you pray for that, and you know life would be different if that would happen, but maybe the decision you need to make is that you would just go and say, everything is clean slate for us. You're forgiven. I forgive you. One decision can radically change your life, drastically alter the course of your life. Today, maybe that decision, I hope it is that today maybe you're sitting here and you say, I sort of feel like I'm supposed to follow Jesus. And I don't know what that means, and I don't know what that's supposed to look like. But I need to do that today. I need to make a declaration of that today. I need to make a declaration of that decision today, and I need to get baptized. Maybe you've been in church for a long time, and you've been around, and you know what church is like, and you know God, and you believe in God, and you recognize that He's there, and so you come to church, and you do lots of good things, and all of that, but you've never actually decided to give Him your decisions, never actually decided to follow Him, never actually decided to change your life to fit His plans. Instead, you try to change Him to fit yours. You've never actually made that decision. Maybe today it's time to decide to follow Jesus, to walk after what He's got for you, to follow the life that He has for you, to listen to His plans instead of your own. Maybe that's just the one decision that will drastically alter your life. In fact, I think it will. As I was preparing for this week, I started thinking about a scripture, a chunk of scripture, and it's entitled The Rich Young Ruler. Some of you know the scripture, but it's in Mark 10, 17 to 31. It's a big chunk of scripture that I'm going to read to you, but it's as Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Well, why do you call me good?" Jesus answers him. You imagine this moment where this guy runs up and throws himself, this rich young guy, this guy who's got everything, throws himself on the ground before Jesus. Obviously in some sort of desperate state, needing of something. Well, wait, he's got everything, but he's needing of something. He throws himself down before Jesus and says, "Hey, what do I do to inherit eternal life? Something in me is not what it needs to be. Something doesn't feel right, even though I have everything that everyone thinks I would need to be happy. Something in me doesn't feel right." He throws himself down before Jesus and says, "What must I do?" Jesus says, "Well, why do you call me good?" Jesus right away recognizes what this rich young ruler is trying to do. He's trying to figure out eternal life through his merits, through his goodness. "Hey, you're good, Jesus. I'm good. Well, you know, let's all be good together. Is that going to fulfill me? Is that going to be enough?" And so Jesus breaks it right away. He says, "Hey, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments." Here he says, here's what you should do. "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, you shall not defraud, and honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all of these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said, "go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven." This is an interesting idea from Jesus. Jesus says, "There's one thing that you lack." You want to know what it is? It's what you have too much of. What a strange conundrum that is. The very thing you lack is the thing that you have too much of. The thing that you lack is what you're overburdened with. It's what you felt like was a blessing all along. The thing that you lack is not what you don't have, it's what you won't give. You won't give that up, so that's what you lack. Because you always lack in faith. You will always lack the fulfillment that Jesus wants to give you. You will always lack the life that he wants to satisfy you with as long as there's something you won't give him. And so Jesus says, here's all you need to do is just go ahead, sell everything you have, give to the poor, you will have treasure in heaven. And then he says, and then make this decision, come follow me. See, sometimes we think following Jesus, we're not sure if it's actually going to give us what we want. Well, if I follow Jesus, well, will I get that money back? Will I get that job back? Will I get that time back? Will my friends come back to me? Because I kind of think it's weird that I'd be following Jesus. Will they listen to me? I've actually kind of made fun of Jesus in my life, and now if I follow him, people are going to think that's kind of strange. Maybe we should do this a different way. What will happen if I actually follow Jesus? And that's why it's a difficult decision. That's why we celebrate the decision. That's why we're going to be pumped when people come out of the waters of baptism today, because it's not just them saying, I believe in God, and that's good, or I'm a good person, and I go to church. No, we're celebrating because they're saying, I want to give my life over to him. I want to follow him. I want to let him direct my steps. I want to walk where he wants me to walk. I want to go where he wants me to go. I want to experience the fullness of what God has for my life. And when that decision is made, this church will start to light up when more and more people start to make that decision. So we're going to celebrate that. That's great news today. That's exciting for us today. We're overjoyed when that happens because it's a difficult decision, not an easy one. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth, because he lacked. And Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" And Jesus looked at them and said, "With man, this is impossible. No good works, you know, no specific merits. We didn't put on this banner, 'I am perfect. I'm getting baptized.' Why? Because I am perfect and I will never sin again." Sploosh. Good. No, I just have made a decision. A decision to what? Never sin again? Oh, I'm going to try because I'm going to follow Jesus. Well, what happens if you sin again? We have to get baptized again? No. You're here saying that I'm following Jesus and he's going to pick me up when I fall and he's going to dust me off when I sin and he's going to meet me when I'm broken and he's going to tell me when I've walked in a wrong direction and I'm going to do my best to turn back to him and I'm going to say sorry again and sorry again and sorry again and sorry again and he's going to forgive me and he's going to meet me and he's going to empower me and he's going to walk alongside me and this is my declaration that I've got a relationship. Not that I'm going to be good enough, but I have a relationship with him and that he wants me and he loves me. He said, "With man, all things are impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Then Peter spoke up. "Hey, we have left everything to follow you." Wait a sec. I love when Peter just gets these light bulb moments. Oh, ding, ding, ding. Hey. Well, we're following you, Jesus. Isn't that awesome? So what do we get? Candy or what? Then Peter spoke up. "We have left everything to follow you. Truly, I tell you," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me or for the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields." Big promise. And then he says, "along with persecutions. And in the age to come, eternal life." Yes, you follow me, I will give you great things. If you follow me with your life, I will pour out blessings in your life, and you will also be persecuted in your life. People won't always understand it in your life. People won't always get this in your life, and you will also have eternal life that starts now and that you will look forward to forever because you have decided that you're not going to bind yourself to this world and the pleasures that it gives, but instead you're going to rely on me for the pleasures and fulfillment of life that only I can offer. So because of that, you're going to get it. He says, "But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." Your lack is not what you don't have, it's what you won't give. My lack is not what I don't have, it's what I won't give. This rich young ruler, if he would have just said, "Okay, I'll give you everything," he would have followed Jesus and his life would have been drastically, incredibly different. One decision is all it would have taken. You know, we read about the disciples, they made this one decision. "Hey, do you want to follow me?" Okay. And put down their nets and they walk after Jesus. And their lives were so changed that now we read about their lives forever after. All we know about the rich young ruler is he was too stuck to his money to follow Jesus. He didn't make any difference in the world as far as we know. Where did his money go? I don't know. What did he buy? I don't know. What ministries did he start? I don't know. What charities did he develop with that? I don't know. We don't hear about any of that. Why? Because he didn't change the world with his money. And yet following Jesus would have. We know that because those who did changed the world, literally changed the world. We still talk about them today. I was reminded about a friend. I almost called him a friend. I've never met this guy in my life, but an author named Nabil Qureshi. This is a book that I read a while back. It's called Seeking Allah, Finding Jesus. And this book really impacted me a few years back. This guy is a Muslim fellow, grew up in a home. His whole family was very strongly committed to the Muslim faith, and they walked this out, and they were living this out. They were very, very strong in this, stronger than I think most Christian homes would be. And so he met this Christian guy. This is his actual story. He met this Christian guy. They were both highly intellectual, and they started logically discussing, okay, what about Christianity? What about Islam? What about these things, and how do they compare, and which one's right, is basically what they started talking about. And we're going to pick up on the story where he has decided logically that Jesus Christ was God, and did die and did rise, but it didn't matter. Even though he knew it logically, it didn't matter. And so he started asking God, and he talks about his story, saying, yeah, I would pray, and I'd say, Allah or Jesus, I don't care who you are, reveal yourself as who you actually are. Tell me about this, because I'm trying to figure this out. So who am I talking to right now? I've been talking to Allah my whole life. Has it actually been me trying to talk? Like, what do I? He just totally hits this point in his life. He says, one way or another, reveal yourself to me so I know who you are. And so this is the second dream that he's about to get. So as I sat on the dream, he just had a dream, for another 2 months, each day the devil's advocate in my mind growing louder and louder. Could I really hinge my life and eternal destiny on a dream? Just one dream? And that dream so symbolic that I needed Ibn Sirin or Joseph to interpret it for me? Perhaps I interpreted the dream in favor of Christianity because subconsciously I wanted Christianity to be true. Or perhaps I wanted Islam to subconsciously be true. So Shaitan was trying his best to trick me into damnation. Like the vision in the hotel room, the dream was just so ambiguous that I could imagine explaining it in a variety of ways. In fact, that is what happened. I shared the dream with Amy, who told me she did not know exactly how all the symbols fit together, but it was a sign from Allah that ought to confirm my confidence in Islam. When I shared the vision and dream with David, that's his Christian friend, he said there was no doubt that the dream pointed me to Christianity. All these thoughts mixed in my head. I did not dare ask God for another dream or vision. In my heart, I knew he had given me one of each, but I was too broken to be sure what they meant. The opposing forces, the uncertainty, and the potential costs almost paralyzed me. Almost. I remembered what David had said about Joseph in the New Testament. God had given him clear instructions through dreams. That was what I needed. And surely if God wanted to guide me, a broken skeptic, he would know that I needed more. Three, I said to myself. Allah likes odd numbers and the Christian God is triune. Why not ask for three dreams? So I returned to Allah in prayer with a very specific request. Instead of just one dream, please give me three. If they all point to Christianity, then I will become Christian. Please, Lord, show me mercy. Please make the next dream so easy to understand that it requires no interpretation. On the morning of March 11, 2005, I had a dream to scrawl onto paper. I am standing at the entrance of a narrow doorway that is built into a wall of brick. I am not in the doorway, but just in front of it. The doorway is an arch. I would say the doorway is about 7.5 feet tall, with about 6.5 feet of its sides being straight up from the ground, and there's a 1-foot arch part on the top capping it off. The doorway is slightly less than 3 feet wide and about 3 or 4 feet deep, all brick. It leads into a room where many people are sitting at tables that have fancy and good food on them. I think I remember salad, but I'm not sure. That's not what I picture, you know, myself. I'm like ice cream sundaes or something, but anyways. They were not eating, but they were all ready to eat, and they were all looking to my left as if waiting for a speaker before the banquet. One of the people at the other side of the door, just inside the room, is David Wood. I am unable to walk into the room because David is occupying the other threshold of the doorway. He is sitting at the table and is also looking to my left. I asked him, I thought we were going to eat together. And he said, without removing his eyes from the front of the room, you never responded. When I woke up from the dream, I immediately had an interpretation. The room was heaven. The feast was a feast in the kingdom of heaven, and it was a wedding feast of sorts. In order to get into the room, I had to respond to David's invitation. If there was one thing I did not get about the dream, it was the door. It is the most dramatic symbol in the dream, but what did it mean? Why was it the most vivid image, and why was it so narrow? By this time, Amy was becoming suspicious of my questions about dreams, and since this one had David in it, there was no way I could ask her what she thought it meant. I called David, though, to see what he thought. Nabil, he responded, this dream is so clear it doesn't need to be interpreted. His words immediately reminded me of what I had prayed to God a few days earlier, asking for more. He told me to read Luke 13:22. Instead of Abba, his dad's, King James Version, I turned to a study Bible that David had given me the previous year as a gift. I had never even opened it until this point. It was a Zondervan NIV study Bible When I arrived at the passage, in big, bold letters, the section heading read, "The Narrow Door." My heart skipped a beat. I had never seen this section of the Bible before. I carefully read it and reread it. Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. Someone asked him, "Lord, are only a few going to be saved?" He said to them, "Make every effort to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside knocking and pleading, 'Sir, open the door for us.' There will be weeping there and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. People will come from east and west and north and south and will take their places at the feast in the kingdom of God." I stopped reading and put the Bible down. I was overwhelmed. God had given me a dream that was so clear that I did not need to interpret it. The interpretation had been recorded in the Bible for 2,000 years. The narrow door was the door to salvation. Jesus was telling me to make every effort to enter it, and I knew from that dream that I needed to respond to David's invitation in order to enter and take my place in the feast of the kingdom of heaven. If I did not enter, I would be left standing outside asking to come in. That is where I stood, just outside the narrow door of salvation, wondering why I had not been let in. Thankfully, the owner had not yet come to close the door. There was now no question left. I knew what I had to do. I had to accept the invitation. How, when I read this, I realized how difficult that is, especially for a guy like that, who's been entrenched in a way of thinking for a long time and a way of seeing life for a long time. This is not an easy decision, but he knew what he had to do. He had to decide. Do I accept what Jesus has done for me or not? Do I accept the cross or not? Do I accept the life that he offers me or not? Do I accept what he has done for me or not? Today, I believe there are going to be some people in here who need to make that decision for themselves. You're going to be questioning in your heart, do I actually believe this? Am I actually following? Do I just show up to church a lot and try to do good things and call myself a Christian because of that? Or have I said that I want to follow Jesus and give him my life? Have I decided that he deserves my thoughts, that he deserves my actions, that he deserves my future? Have I decided that or not? I think that God is going to be stirring up in some of your hearts that today might be the day that you have to make that decision. And it's a great decision. I'm excited for that decision for you. Well, in the Bible, we see when that decision is made, baptism almost always follows. In the New Testament, Peter is telling a story to all of these people, these Jewish people who have been living a good life as best they could, but not really following Jesus, in fact, fully against Jesus. And Peter gives this story about Jesus, and he speaks it out, and it says it cuts them to the heart, and they say, "Well, what should we do, Peter? You know, what should we do with this? You just told us this huge story about Jesus who's now dead and you're saying has risen from the dead. What are we supposed to do with this story? Because it feels like we need to respond in some way." And he says, "Repent." In other words, turn from following that life and turn to following the life Jesus wants you to follow and be baptized. It just goes one and the same. He says it's just together. Repent and be baptized. Turn to him and be baptized. That's what I want for you. Later on, we see a few other stories. One of them is so incredible with Philip, and this, which is one of the apostles, and he's wandering along, and God says, "I want you to go down this road." He goes down this road. He finds this Ethiopian eunuch reading the Bible, trying to figure out what is going on. Okay, we had this Jesus God come, and then he died. Now people are saying he rose, and he's digging into the Bible, trying to figure it out. And Philip comes up to him and says, "Can I explain it to you?" It says he told him all about Jesus. The life that he came and how the whole Bible pointed to him and to this day and where it was at. And the Ethiopian eunuch eventually says, "Well, there's some water. Let's go get baptized. What's stopping us? Let's go jump in there. Let's just make it happen." He was so compelled that he wanted to follow Jesus so much that he wanted to make a moment to remember it. Baptism in lots of ways is just a recognition of what's already happened in your heart. This baptism isn't salvation. Baptism isn't, now finally God can love me because I've been baptized. Baptism is that moment that we will all remember with you, that you will remember from this moment on, that if, when you get dunked, when you go underwater, all of a sudden, like, this isn't what you do every single day, you know? This doesn't happen every single day. This is that moment where you say, I have decided. I'm not about to decide when I go on the water. I'm not going to see if I decide when I get out of the water. I have decided. I am a follower of Jesus. I am with him. He is my God. He is going to lead my life. He is going to direct my steps. And because of that, I want everyone else to know it. And I'm going to get baptized, and then I'm going to probably fail a little bit in life, and I'm going to have to learn some things, and I'm going to have to sort it out, and I'm not going to be perfect. Perfect just because I got baptized, but I am going to seek the perfect Jesus, and I'm going to tell the whole world about it by being baptized. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. So today, we are going to have some people get baptized. I don't know if you noticed that I'm wearing this nice little shirt that says, I have decided. People are like, wow, I can't believe he's matching all of this stuff today. That was intentional. Today, maybe you want to be wearing one of these shirts as well. Maybe you come to church for a long time and you just haven't been baptized and you sort of say, it's been too long now, it's not worth it, I don't need to get baptized. Maybe today is your day and Jesus is stirring up in your heart saying, hey, you've never done this, why don't you just follow through? Why don't you join the ranks that have happened throughout history with Peter and all the apostles and all of these people? Why don't you get baptized today? If that's you, we've made some space for you. Pastor Joel is going to be hanging out at the back, and we do full submersion baptisms here because we believe that we are fully becoming new people when Jesus comes into our heart, and that's the representation of this, that you leave your old self there. Sorry for the last people getting baptized and all the old selves in the water, but you leave your old self there and you come out of the water. It's like you put the old self in the grave and you come out into new life. And I'll tell you something, this is the most exciting day in Christianity for us as a church. This is the day where we celebrate. People have decided to follow Jesus, and since they have, they've decided to get baptized. So, if you feel like you're not ready, I have one extra pair of shorts in my office, and we've got a whole free store out back, don't we, Audrey? Hey? And so if we need to run and get you shorts, we will. We've got a few extra shirts that we'd love to get you baptized. And you won't be on the video, but we can make another video for you later on. We're going to do a baptism service now. So I'd like to invite the worship team up. Pastor Joelle is going to be out in the lobby, and she's got some T-shirts. How about anyone who's already decided they were going to get baptized, but anyone else who also says, I want to follow Jesus with my life, and I've never been baptized, either because I just made the decision now, or I'm going to make the decision, or I've made the decision years ago and I've just never been baptized. If that's you, why don't you just stand up and join them as well? Let's give it up for the people. Whoever's decided, go ahead and you can go on out. If there's new people, you can head on out. Come on, praise God. There they go. Here's our candidates. They're going to go and get ready. Get ready to be baptized. If you want to join them right now. If you want to be part of that, join them right now because Pastor Joel's got a shirt for you and would love to have you in the tank with us. But I want to tell you, as they're going to go and get ready and get changed, and then I'm going to go and get ready and get changed after this, that this is exciting. This is a thrilling time. And so when people are going to get baptized, these guys are going to be playing some music, a song called I Have Decided. Fitting, and they're just going to be playing over. We're about to show a testimony video from our baptism candidates who are saying, "Yeah, I'm going to get dunked and I'm going to get baptized and I have decided to follow Jesus." They're going to share their story in video, and these guys are going to be playing over that video and then leading us into it. Let this be a time of worship for you. Let this be an exciting time of worship. When the video plays, then you'll just start to see us go in there, and you won't hear our conversations, but I'll be saying, do you want to follow Jesus for the rest of your life? Do you believe that his death and resurrection sets you free and allows you to live in a new way and gives you eternal life? And then we'll say, and in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, we want to baptize you, and we're going to dunk people. And when they come up out of that water, it's our job as a church to be as excited as we should be at this moment. All right? So we're going to be worshiping, and we're going to be singing. We're going to be spending time doing this. But when they come up out of the water, we're going to cheer like nobody's business. All right? We're going to make this an exciting time for them. We're going to make this an exciting time for us. We're going to make this a declaration that this isn't the end, that there is so much more, so many more decisions that are going to happen in the Comox Valley and in our communities and in our families because we believe that Jesus is doing something new and changing lives again. Is that all right? Amen. Amen. Well, then I'm going to go and get my shorts on and get all ready. But these guys are going to go ahead and play a little video about the testimony.
Hi, my name is Maya.
My name is Ryan.
My name is Ayla.
My name is Jordan Lucas.
My name is Brad.
My name is Jennifer.
My name is Ryan.
My name is Mark. Life before Christ for me was, it was dark, lonely, and just felt lost all the time. Wasn't happy.
My life before I knew Jesus was kind of plain. Didn't really do much.
I felt like a lot of my friends were pushing away from me and I was getting into a lot of drama, especially at school. It made me feel very sad.
Before I made the decision to follow Jesus, it was, he wasn't really a part of my life at all, and I only knew him on the once a week Sunday.
It was really different. It was a lot harder.
Before I knew Jesus, my life was confusing. I always felt off balance, like I was just all over the place all the time.
Before I came back to Christ, it was very angry and lonely life.
It was a lot of battles within myself, challenges, searching.
The moment I found Christ, I was actually in a recovery center, and I kept being told to pray out loud, but I didn't really believe then, and I just felt broken, and I did. I tried. I laid in bed. I prayed out loud. I had this overwhelming feeling, and I feel like I saw something when I was laying in my bed, and I came here after that weekend. I came here, and I've never left, and it just felt right.
I made the decision to follow Jesus around October during Consumed, and in those few moments I just was consumed with knowing him.
Since I came to church, it was a kind of a different kind of perspective on like everything. My attitude kind of changed.
This year, when we went to the Light It Up conference, I really felt that Jesus really touched me, and it was the first time I was actually able to speak to him.
Life has been pretty cool since knowing Jesus. I now think of him daily, I pray to him often, and I'm adding on to the Sunday, and it's just so good to know that he's going to be part of my life forever.
My life is a lot easier knowing him. I can always go to him if I need help with something, or I can ask him if I need something.
The first time I accepted Christ into my Lord, it was fulfilling. It gave me purpose.
Since I've come back to the Lord, I definitely say my life is full of joy and peace, and I'm surrounded by many people who love me.
It was actually a sermon that Pastor Evan said, and that just did all the connections for me with the work that I do today. So I'm not ashamed anymore saying I believe in Christ, I believe in God, which before, I was feeling awkward about it.
I like to say thank you to my dad for introducing me to church and everything.
I just want to thank Northgate Church for being here for me, because it's a huge part of why I'm how I am today.
I would like to thank Pastor Joel and my grandma.
I would like to say thank you to my parents, who've always been there to support my decisions, and especially a big thank you to Jillian Thompson, who's been my mentor, and she answered billions of my questions, so thank you.
I would like to thank my mom and my grandma and Pastor Allen for encouraging me to get baptized and being there for me.
I'd like to thank my grandmother, Shirley Martindale. She helped me get to this point in my life.
So I think for me to be able to get to where I'm at today, my mom's a missionary, and all her friends have faithfully prayed for me for 25 years. And I'd like to thank all of them.
I would like to thank, first of all, my wife, Jillian, my in-laws, the family, the whole church.
Well, I want to get baptized because I want to accept Jesus into my life.
I want to get baptized because my life has changed drastically since I found Jesus, and he saved me, and I'm willing to give my life for that and show it.
I just want to accept Jesus.
I want to get baptized because I want the community to know that I'm ready, for them to know that I want Jesus in my life now and forever.
Because I love Jesus and I want to accept him into my heart.
I want to get baptized to be closer to the Lord.
I want to get re-baptized because coming back to the Lord, I have a completely different outlook on what my relationship is with him, and I just want to make a stance and show that I love the Lord.
I feel him in me, and I feel Christ, I feel God, and I want to be totally connected. And yes, I was baptized as a baby, but now it's a choice of mine.
Decided, follow Jesus, no turning back.